Good morning. My name is Brandy Howard. I'm a staff attorney with Lone Star Legal Aid. Welcome to our morning local law live session. This morning we will discuss the topic, what is mediation and how you can use it to resolve a dispute. During this discussion, we will only provide general information about the mediation process. We will not provide legal advice. If you need legal advice on a specific situation, please call Lone Star Legal Aid on our toll-free number at 1-800-733-8394. We will also have in the comments our contact information if you have any more questions on how to contact us. Also, joining us today is a volunteer from the McClennan County Dispute Resolution Center. We will have her or that organization's contact information in the comment section as well if you want to reach out to them for any specific questions. We have two panelists with us this morning. We have Chris Houston. She is a volunteer with the McClennan County Dispute Resolution Center. And we have Brittany Hightower. She's a staff attorney. I'm gonna ask both of them to briefly introduce themselves. So Chris, if you would go first, if you could just tell us a little bit about your legal background and what it is that you do in your volunteer work with the McClennan County Dispute Resolution Center.
Hi everyone, I'm happy to, Ms. Howard. My name is Chris Houston. I am a native Houstonian, which is kind of cool, Houston from Houston. I live in Waco now, and I have recently joined the board of directors for the McClennan County Dispute Resolution Center. I'm also a volunteer attorney mediator with the McClennan County Dispute Resolution Center. I have been a law professor for 15 years. Most of that time I taught at the law school level, also designing and directing legal research and writing programs and academic support and bar preparation programs. Currently, I teach business law part-time, and I have a wills and estate planning practice. I am also a volunteer with Lone Star Legal Aid, so I find that to be a neat coincidence as I make a career transition from teaching to practicing more. I thought that it would be a great way to serve the community and to learn some new areas of the law and hone some practical lawyering skills. So I have a love for Lone Star Legal Aid because I have enjoyed the pro bono legal work that I've done. I also have a love for mediation. I was trained at the Harris County Dispute Resolution Center, and I've done mediations for them of various types. I also resided in San Antonio before coming to Waco. So I did a lot of mediations and was a trainer for the peer mediation program that is in Bexar County in San Antonio. And currently I am doing a lot of family law and CPS mediations. I think since the pandemic has been extended, some of the civil litigation disputes they're just saying, fine, we're ready to mediate. But I think they tried to kind of ride out this coronavirus pandemic wave, and the wave just doesn't seem to be dissipating. So we're seeing more civil mediations, but the bulk of the mediations that we do in McClennan County are family and CPS. And it's been great. It's been a great experience. You know, it's tough. Those are very emotionally charged types of mediations, very different from a breach of contract or a neighbor dispute or something. But learning a lot, growing a lot, and doing what I love. So thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for being with us this morning, Chris. Brittany, would you tell us a little bit about your what you do for Lone Star Legal Aid, and then what you did in your prior experience before coming on board with Lone Star Legal Aid?
Yeah, I would love to. So as Brandy said, my name is Brittany Hightower. I'm a staff attorney with our LASA program unit within Lone Star Legal Aid. So I'm based out of the Belton office, but I serve a specialty unit that focuses on providing different kinds of legal services to survivors of some form of sexual violence. That program came about as part of the LASA grant, and we're really part of a larger network. So we work together with other grantees such as Tahoe Justice Center in Houston or other legal aid providers such as Legal Aid of Northwest Texas to kind of provide holistic services for survivors of sexual violence. So similar to what Chris was saying, a bulk of what we'll see or what I work on is going to be the family type cases, so divorce, custody, protective orders, But we also do a bunch of other things like landlord-tenant cases, property rights, privacy, all sorts of different things. Prior to my experience here at Lone Star Legal Aid, I've worked at the Attorney General's Office in the Child Support Division. I was a prosecutor for the Williamson County Attorney's Office. And then I got my start doing pretty similar work at Texas Advocacy Project, where I had the pleasure of working with Brandy before.
Thank you, Brittany. Just a little bit about myself. I'm also a staff attorney with Lone Star Legal Aid. I do lots of different things there, such as helping clients in addiction cases. That's a big thing that's going on right now, when as people are hurting with the loss of service jobs out there. So we've been doing a lot of eviction work. I also do help our clients who are older adults and have and those with disabilities that have been victimized in some way with family law cases and getting protective orders in place. Prior to coming on at Lone Star Legal Aid, I was also a prosecutor with Williamson County Attorney's Office and represented CPS in removal cases or foster care cases. I also worked with Disability Rights Texas and represented children with disabilities that were in foster care and helping them advocate for them and making sure their needs were being met. So let's dive right into our topic today. So Chris, you're the mediator in the panel. Can you tell us what mediation is?
Yes, ma'am. I have a short presentation. Is this the time that I should get started with it?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Okay. And let me work on the screen share. Can you see the screen, ladies?
Yes. Perfect. Looks good.
All right. So in order for me to see the entire slide, I'm going to minimize the Zoom bar. So if you need to speak to me or if there's an issue hearing me, just let me know. Because I'll be able to hear you better than I'll be able to see you. All right, so I'm here today to talk to you about what mediation is. So let's dive right in. I want us to gain a little bit of context so that we can understand the reason that we should be looking to mediation as one type of conflict resolution, or more specifically, alternative dispute resolution. So I would like to position mediation in the context of ADR, or alternative dispute resolution, as a conflict resolution tool. So mediation is one strategy for conflict resolution, and if time permits, we can talk about a few others. I think the big one that we as lawyers on this panel think of is litigation. Conflict resolution is a process of resolving a dispute or a conflict by meeting at least some of each side's needs and addressing their interests. Alternative dispute resolution, or ADR, is a type of conflict resolution as well. It is a process in which a neutral third party, a mediator or an arbitrator, helps parties who are embroiled in a dispute come to an agreement. Mediation and arbitration are types of alternative dispute resolution because they offer an alternative to litigation. So what is mediation exactly? In mediation, a neutral third party tries to help disputants reach a consensus on their own. Disputants is just a technical term for people who are in a conflict. Rather than imposing a solution, a professional mediator seeks to assist the conflicting sides in exploring the interests underlying their positions. Working with parties either together or sometimes separately, mediators try to help the parties agree on a resolution that is sustainable, voluntary, and non-binding. And a word on that. Mediation is to be distinguished from arbitration because arbitration is generally regarded as a binding type of alternative dispute resolution, whereas mediation is considered non-binding. However, the mediated settlement agreement that is reached, if the parties actually come to an agreement, is like a contract and it can be enforced in court. So in that way, that mediated settlement agreement is binding. So, mediators can help disputants break an impasse by doing the following. finding additional information that parties were unwilling to share with each other, overcoming parties' resistance to communicating and reaching an agreement by presenting offers to both sides, contributing impartial, specialized expertise, and brainstorming options to find a resolution that satisfies both parties. A mediator cannot impose an outcome like a judge can, but rather assists the disputing parties in reaching their own agreement. Mediation can be used in a wide range of disputes, including labor disputes, public policy disputes, disagreements among nations, family disputes, and even neighborhood and community quarrels. According to research, about 80% of dispute mediations lead to resolution. This is a statistic that I pulled from the Harvard Project on Negotiation, and they have a huge program that is designed to train mediators, arbitrators, and other ADR professionals around the world. So I thought that statistic was one worth noting. If the parties can come to an agreement that mediation might help them to resolve their conflict, 80% of the time, mediation can lead to a resolution of that conflict. So in conclusion, I would just like to talk about the benefits of mediation. I want to let you know that some of these benefits are offered in the context of looking at mediation versus litigation, and some of these benefits are offered generally because there does not have to be a pending lawsuit for mediation to be taken advantage of as a means for conflict resolution. So let's look at some of the benefits of mediation before I close. Resolving litigation without the expense and uncertainty of trial is one benefit. One of the things that is so important when people are reluctant to put aside their differences and try to resolve their conflicts in a mediation is to remind them that a settlement yields a win-win solution in which both parties reach a mutual agreement to resolve the issues being litigated. The judge does not often care about fashioning a win-win solution for both parties. The judge is impartial in a different way than a mediator would be, and they typically apply the law, and there's very little regard for people's feelings, what they would like to see happen, or anything else. Mediators can be experienced legal professionals who may be able to offer insight into the weaknesses of your case or litigation outcome. There are different types of mediations. Sometimes mediations can be evaluative, and lawyers and parties will use mediations to evaluate the strength of their case. Parties can openly exchange information because mediation is a confidential process. Parties can creatively craft solutions to their issues without being tightly restrained by legal rules. So there's things like rules of procedure, rules of evidence, and even rules that determine the type of relief a party can obtain in court that merely do not apply in mediation context. Now, you cannot have a mediated settlement agreement in which you agree to do something illegal. But beyond that, there's a lot more creativity available to the parties who need to resolve their dispute in the context of a mediation. Mediation is often faster. It's a faster resolution than going to trial. I'm from Houston. It takes a long time to get to trial in a bigger city. And so if a resolution, a more timely resolution is sought, mediation is something that should definitely be considered. Mediators are also trained to bring plaintiffs and defendants to a happy medium to help them come up with a win-win solution. Parties in conflict can salvage or repair their relationship. That is not something that is even really the goal of litigation. But think about the divorce context in which two people who were married and who have children who have to co-parent still need to be in each other's lives and still need to have healthy communication in order to properly parent their children. One benefit of mediation in helping them to settle their divorce is that there can be work done to salvage and, in the best case scenario, repair the relationship to a certain extent so that people are better positioned to co-parent in a healthy manner. Parties also have more control over the outcome of their settlement Never is that the case when you go before the judge or the jury. Parties also have an equal say in the outcome. I've seen situations where one party, let's just stay with the divorce example. Let's say the wife has an attorney and the husband does not. Even still, they will have an equal say in the outcome in the mediation. And finally, when there is a dispute, especially a big dispute, like a personal injury matter or a labor, employment discrimination or labor dispute, in mediation, there is no admission of fault. So the dispute can be resolved without any person accepting fault or blame. And I think that's another great benefit of mediation. So specifically, before we move to the next person, I've been asked to talk about the specific services that the McClennan County Dispute Resolution Center offers. So one of the things that I'm very proud of is that we jumped on the wave of virtual mediations when the coronavirus pandemic caused the stay-at-home orders to be issued throughout Texas. As a matter of fact, one of the things that is possible for other dispute resolution centers, I know for a fact, Montgomery County outside of Houston has taken advantage of this, is that we at McClennan County have now began to provide trainings for other dispute resolution centers who want to either begin or do more online mediations. We have family mediations, and you can do a full or a half day. So if you really need to save money or time, that half day option is there. And that is also the case for civil mediations. We do CPS mediations, divorce settlements, landlord-tenant disputes, business conflicts, breach of contract, financial disputes, neighbor disputes, parent-teen conflicts, school conflicts, workplace disputes, prisoner reentry conflicts, and so much more. I think the take-home point from this slide is that the mediation can be connected to litigation, it can be done to try to ward off litigation, or it can be a way to dissolve disputes where there's never any thought of going into court, but there's a conflict, like between neighbors or parents and teens, that needs to be resolved. These are some of the sources that I use. I always, as a lawyer, believe in giving attribution to sources. And I will take questions at the end of the entire presentation if there is a need. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. I think you secretly looked in on my outline because you covered everything that I was going to ask you. Great job.
Very wonderful thorough. Vibe.
Thank you. So Brittany, we as attorneys are kind of on the, and Chris too, when you've got your attorney hat on, but Brittany, just from your view, what is your role as the attorney in the mediation where you're representing a party in the conflict or dispute?
So when I think about my role as an attorney or as an advocate for somebody going through the mediation process, I like to think of myself as a guide through the process. It's really about making sure your client is in the driver's seat and they're making the decisions, but you're kind of the navigator. You're really making sure that they understand what's happening, what the process entails, what their rights are, what their options are. Make sure that any that come back from the other side, that they clearly understand what it is, what the legal implications are, how it could benefit them, how it could hurt them, how there are certain situations where giving, quote unquote, giving the other side what they want is actually a benefit to your client. And Brandy, you and I have talked about this before. There's different kinds of roles that an attorney advocate can have in this situation. Sometimes, depending on your client, the facts, your relationship with your client, the relationship between the two parties, you may want to take the lead and your client may want you to take the lead where you're really doing the most of the communicating. And then there's other times where you're kind of doing it as a team. You're letting your client answer questions, ask questions, make demands. And then there's other times where you really need to take a back seat and let your client just lead the whole way and just be there as a kind of as a resource or as information if the client needs it, because you've talked about it and prepared ahead of time and your client knows exactly what's going on. So really, focusing more on just being the guide for your client, the navigator, and letting them make the decision about what's going to be best, how engaged you're going to be.
If you have a client that's never been through mediation, how do you help them prepare? And then if you have a mediator that you've never worked with before, how do you prepare the mediator for the mediation? Can you give us an example of what you typically do to help your client and the mediator prepare for the mediation?
That's an excellent question. So when I'm preparing with my client, the first thing I'm always going to ask them, what are our must-haves and what are some things that are kind of less important? And Chris touched on this. One of the really important things to recognize about mediation is to really craft creative solutions that get your client what they need rather than what a judge thinks is most important. So the best example I can give is child support. The state thinks it's incredibly important, which it is. Judges often think that it is the single most important thing we need to focus on in most custody cases. And I will say not infrequently, we sometimes have clients where it's more important for them to be able to move to another city because that's where their job prospects are. You know, I had a client where she was going to be graduating from school, had a guaranteed job in another city, and the jurisdiction we were in had pretty restrictive geographic restrictions. The judge is going to impose it in almost every case. But for my client, whatever amount she was going to get in child support was not going to be anywhere near worth what she was going to get when she was able to move to a bigger city and get a job making three times what she could in the city where she was at. So she was ready and willing to give up child support, which seemed ludicrous to the Attorney General's office. But for her, being able to go to work and get a better job was much more important than staying in that service industry job and getting child support. So really focusing on what your client wants and what she's willing to give up. I say she because the majority of my clients are female. And then when it comes to preparing the mediator needs to know what they're dealing with. Most of the time, they've never met the parties. Sometimes they've never met the attorneys. They need to know what they're walking into. Is this a situation where we mostly have everything resolved? They just feel very strongly about the geographic restriction or where the kids are going to go to school, whether it's private Catholic school or the local public school. And then other times, these people can't agree on what color the sky is. And so the mediator really needs to know what they're walking into. So we always prepare a brief, if you will, kind of a summary of the case and what's going on, the history of litigation, where we're at here, and really what the core issues are and what we expect the kind of the bigger barriers to be to reaching an agreement.
Yeah, that's really good, Brittany. When I'm working with clients and we're preparing for mediation, I'm usually getting them, helping them have reasonable expectations of what's going to happen, what is reasonable to request or to demand. And then, like you said, just knowing what is their walk away, you know, what deal, what is the least that they will get that they're and where they say, I'm done, I'm going to walk away. And just being prepared so they know going in what they want and then where we have room for negotiating on and then when we need to walk away. Also, helping them understand, I think, is important. What the day is going to look like. It is a long day sometimes, or a long morning, or a long afternoon. Sometimes you have a day mediation, or sometimes you have a half a day. And the mediator usually has snacks, so that's really cool, or and water to kind of keep your physical needs met, everyone's physical needs met during the day. But it is a long process, and sometimes you will be in a room with your client by yourself, and most of the time, and for when we're working with clients that are survivors of family violence or intimate partner violence or sexual assault, and the abusers on the other side, we want to make sure that they're in that room. You're in your room with your client the whole time, and they're not interacting with that abuser. So sometimes they're stuck in that room with you all the entire time, unless they go out to the bathroom. And so helping them just kind of understand what's going to happen throughout the day or the half a day, and just how the room's going to be set up, where the bathrooms are. Just those basic things kind of helps clients kind of feel comfortable about the process itself. Also, like you said, Brittany, walking through what type of strategy you're going to be using when working with the mediator, because the clients are not going to be seeing more than often the other side, the other party that they're disputing with. They're going to be just with you, and then they'll be seeing the mediator who's going to be coming between rooms to room, between the two rooms. You want to remind them that it's just going to be us talking with the mediator. You don't have to worry about saying anything in front of the other party, unless you do. Sometimes mediation start with the opening. We call it a plenary session where everyone's in the same room and everyone kind of gives their opening about what they want to see happen in mediation. And that's something, if your client doesn't feel comfortable having at all, we can ask the mediator to just not have that at all and nix that plenary session. So I think it's important to also walk through what the day is going to look like, what's going to happen, what is the mediator there for, what are they there for? And then always remind them that whatever we talk about is confidential. Whatever we share with the mediator is going to be confidential unless we give the mediator permission to disclose that information to the other side. And there's very few scenarios when that information cannot be kept confidential. So one of the things I think is very important for clients that come to Lone Star Legal Aid for services, they can't often afford to pay for their own attorney. So they're not going to be able to afford, more often than not, the cost of mediation. So Chris, I'm going to go to you, and can you tell me a little bit about how, if clients can afford the cost of mediation through the McClennan County Dispute Resolution Center, what are their options?
So funny you ask, because it was my suggestion that the McClennan County Dispute Resolution Center explore a partnership with the Lone Star Waco branch office, because we're actually in the same building. And this is the conversation, right? The cost aspect of it depends on the location. I think, for example, in Houston, if the mediation was court ordered or if there was a lawsuit in progress, one of the ways around that upfront cost that you have to be prepared for if you hire the services of a mediator or a dispute resolution center is covered, because a lot of times the judges will order the mediation. And if that is the case, there is no cost attached with it. And in Houston, for example, probably because it's bigger resource pool, mediators would just go to the courts and wait for cases to come up. And then we were prepared to go to one of the side rooms in the courthouse and handle the mediations. I do believe that even if the judge had not ordered the mediation, that if parties or their lawyers requested them, I think that they would be able to take advantage of those opportunities without having to pay. One of the other things that I think is possible, because some dispute resolution centers are nonprofits like Lone Star Legal Aid is, and I think there are funds set aside for different costs associated with servicing the clients. And so I think that that is one thing to look into. In a lot of the cities where there is a law school or more than one law school, there may be opportunities for faculty and students who are in alternative dispute resolution courses or mediation courses, or like, for example, Baylor Law School here in Waco has a program where they actually train students to become, to meet the statutorily required hours for becoming a mediator. The University of Houston Law Center has that, and maybe even South Texas. Those students need people to practice their skills on. And so there can be opportunities, just like law school clinics, where students under the supervision of professors are helping the public, clients, members of the public. Usually there's a great relationship because those clinical programs have similar income requirements to a Lone Star or an organization like that. So those are some of the ways that the cost can be reduced. The other thing is that half-day mediation is a lot, it costs less, and it's an option when perhaps none of those other options are financially feasible.
Thank you, Chris. Brittany, how, in your experience in helping clients during mediations, how do you help clients that can't afford mediation take advantage of mediation, like get there, get to the table, get to the room with the mediator? How do you help them when they can't afford it?
I've been fortunate in that most of my cases, we've had a free dispute resolution center. For example, we've been fortunate in Bryan College Station, where it's kind of a downside because the court's always going to order mediation. It's required in every case, even if you object to it. But we're fortunate to have a really great dispute resolution center there, and they're free. If basically if we're representing them, that's, they just don't charge anything. We don't even really have to jump through any hoops or demonstrate that the client can't afford to pay because they understand we've already vetted that up front. But in counties where that's just not an option, one recourse is to file a motion with the court and ask the court to order the other side to pay for it. If the other side has a private attorney, I'm always going to do that. Because on its face, it just doesn't seem fair. My client can't afford an attorney, which is why they have a free attorney. Why should they be required by the court to pay for some sort of mediation when the other side can clearly afford a private attorney? And more often than not, in my experience, when negotiating with the other side, if we both think that we can reach an agreement in mediation, it's much more cost effective for the other side just to go ahead and pay the fee and move forward that way. So I will say, I think I've been fortunate in most of my cases where it's worked out one way or the other.
And Brittany, just a follow-up question for you. I know I've had experiences where mediation may not be required, but I don't think it's a good idea to pursue mediation because of multiple reasons. Is there an example that you have in your experience where you've recommended to a client that maybe mediation isn't the best option?
Definitely. I had one case where there had been an extensive history. They've been married for decades. I think 40 years at this point. Extensive physical, sexual abuse. He was very controlling. He controlled all the finances. She'd never worked a day in her life unless it was for his private company that he had. She had literally no understanding of what was going on other than day-to-day bills. He let her pay some, like the light bill. She had no idea whether there was a mortgage on the property, how much property they owned. We just weren't in a position to negotiate because you always want them to have informed consent. So unless your client knows what's going on and what the legal consequences are of saying yes or saying no to an offer, which is your job as an attorney advocate, but also if they don't even know what's out there and they don't even know what they're saying yes to or what the alternatives are because they don't know how much property is there, what the property is worth, it's just never a good position because you can't have informed consent and you don't even know whether it's a good agreement or not. And then you add in the history of domestic violence, your client's just going to be at a significant advantage. And that's one where we were required to go to mediation. And I basically put my foot down halfway through and said, I'm not going to let her agree to anything. This is just not going to happen because I don't even know if it's fair to her or not.
So you would agree that going to mediation with an abuser and your client is scared and in fear of what will happen to them after that mediation may not be the best idea. Is there options for that client to ask the court to not require the case to go to mediation in those situations?
Absolutely. So if you're in a divorce and there's no children and your client has been the victim of domestic violence, or the other person has committed domestic violence against your client, or if you're in a custody dispute and it's either the children or your client that's been the victim at the hands of the other person, you can always object to mediation. Even if you know your judge is still going to order it, it's still worth objecting because once you've made that objection and the court decides to overrule that and order mediation anyway, there's certain protections that the court is required to make, including keeping the party separate, making sure they have no face-to-face contact, just really making sure that it's as safe as possible for your client. And I will say I'm glad Chris mentioned it earlier, because one odd blessing about this pandemic is the rise the increased use of virtual mediation, because that has been made a night and day difference for so many of my clients. Just it guarantees that they're not going to be in the same room. It guarantees that they're going to have little to no face-to-face contact. It's just a much safer route to go.
I agree. Have you done a virtual mediation yet? Brittany, have you had to do one yet?
Yeah.
What was your experience?
I've done a couple and I was very thrilled with them. One in particular, it was a very contentious case. My client was very traumatized. It was a recipe for failure. Like, we really should not have been able to reach an agreement. And we actually did come up with a very creative solution. And I think in no small part because my client was able to be at home in her own safe environment, know that there was no chance she was going to run into him. And she could just turn off her screen if she needed to. If we were, you know, the mediator was speaking to the other side, she would just turn off her screen and hang out and watch a TV show, work on her homework until the mediator came back. And you could just see, you know, we would be discussing an issue and she would just be so, emotion would just be very intense on her face. And she would be tearful and just having a very, very difficult time processing it. And then the mediator would go talk to the other side. She would have, you know, 20, 30 minutes to decompress, again, work on her homework, watch a comforting TV show, and she'd be a totally different person by the time the mediator got back. And that's just something we, even as nice as I am and as much as I like to get along with my clients, that's just something that I personally can't offer. It was just a wonderful experience.
I'm glad that worked out. Chris, how are mediations going over at the McClennan County Dispute Resolution Center with the virtual setting? How is that working out for you as a mediator?
We are 100% online.
Okay.
And we have been since March. So we, and I think that the volume of mediations may have dwindled a little bit, but I think as courts started doing Zoom more and as people started to see that this pandemic was here to stay for a while, the volume of requests for mediations picked up and we've been pretty busy for a small town like Waco. We've been pretty busy. I want to add to that conversation about mediating in the context of family violence, be it domestic or be it child abuse. One other protection that those children or those spouses who are victims of abuse has is that we as mediators are trained. There are separate trainings for family because of this situation. And it is a situation in which it is clear that mediation requires people to have equal bargaining power. And if you have been abused in any way by the other party, there's questions as to whether you can freely speak, communicate, and negotiate without fear for your safety. And we also have the ability, just like the lawyers, to ask questions, to investigate, gain enough information to determine that there is a serious abuse concern that makes us question whether the parties will be able to mediate in good faith. Because think about it. A person who has abused and controlled, are they really looking to like settle and give and take and so forth? And also whether there's a question of unequal power and fear. And so we can also call a mediation for the safety of that person who's the victim of abuse. So I'm glad because we're all women on here. We know that those concerns for women and children have not always been with us in the legal context at all, right? The law had typically been very biased against women and children.
Absolutely. I'm just so glad that there are people like you, Chris, who do this work, because it's, like you said, it's been a lot of decades of trying to train and teach people who were in the legal field, and it's nice to finally be in a position where we all get it. So that's awesome. Thank you.
And Chris, you're virtual now, but when you're back open and the COVID-19 pandemic is thankfully one day, improved. Does your office have a setup so that it is safe, a safe space where a survivor of intimate partner violence can feel safe when they come to your office for a mediation if their abuser is the other party?
And not just because of the high number of family cases that we take, but also because we take a high number of CPS cases. So the way that this office is set up, there are about five rooms. Even though it's a small center, I think that's a large number of rooms because it allows for different parties to be separated. And the other thing is that there is a lobby and then there is an office area and there are two entrances. You can either take the lobby entrance or you can take the other entrance. And I think that that is also so that those parties don't have to even come in or leave the same entrance. And finally, when we have divorce cases that are problematic for different reasons, including maybe some kind of physical, and I really want to highlight the part about the verbal and the emotional abuse, taking the same type of toll on the spouses and the children, right? We are sensitive to those things. And so even if there are no documented allegations of physical violence, we still try to monitor the situation to see if we feel that there's any reason for us to have people coming and going out of different doors. We never release the parties at the same time. We hold the parties until the other one is not just out of the office, but out of the elevator and out of the building. We even give them enough time to get in the car and drive off because we want to keep people safe. And the truth of the matter is this, just like in a litigation situation, if there has been abuse, if there has been unequal power, that party that has abused power, that has used abuse and intimidation to get their way throughout that relationship, may still come back at the other party and try to get them to change their minds about the mediated settlement agreement. So we try to keep people feeling comfortable enough to actually negotiate for what they need and want.
Thank you. So ladies, we're going to wrap it up. Is there anything else that I didn't ask that you'd like to discuss or say?
I want to talk just really briefly, and I know Brittany has experience with this, about the virtual mediation setting. There are mixed feelings among judges, lawyers, clients, and I think that there are a lot of conveniences beyond the health and safety precautions. If parties are in different cities or states, cost and convenience concerns are taken care of. But I also think that even after the pandemic, ladies, I think that virtual mediations will be a thing because of how efficient it is to do them. There are drawbacks, and if you want to talk about them, we can. But I think they create additional concerns for confidentiality.
Yeah.
I have had to call several mediations because there were third parties with no stake in the matter who were visibly and obviously exerting influence on one of the parties. And so things like confidentiality have to be discussed, and you have to Zoom fatigue is another thing. It's so much easier to keep people's attention when you're face to face. Those are just a few things. I know you want to wrap up, but there is a need for us to look at what mediating in a virtual setting looks like and to prepare lawyers and to prepare people who may need the services of a mediator for them, because I think this phenomenon is going to be with us.
I'll just quickly, just second what Chris said, there are drawbacks. One of the other issues we run into as well is lack of resources. If your client doesn't have access to a device, doesn't have a smartphone, doesn't have Wi-Fi, it can create a barrier just like in every other aspect in their lives. But I do agree with Chris. I think the benefits do outweigh the shortcomings, and we can do things to address the shortcomings because it is more efficient, and it does include the safety protections that I think are paramount.
I agree. I had a mediation where the free mediator was hundreds of miles away. And so we were able to try to do the mediation virtually. So that was a very big cost benefit for my client. But she was able to participate, and she had all her, you know, she had a laptop, and she had everything she needed, a camera and the microphone working on her laptop. But I have other clients that we haven't gone mediation, and they can't even participate really on the virtual hearings. They have to call in for those hearings just in the court setting. So I know it would be a struggle for most of my clients that are older or have disabilities where they cannot get the virtual settings to work for them. So that is kind of one of the drawbacks, even in the court system where we're doing all of these hearings virtually, having the equipment and the resources to participate in those hearings.
Agreed.
Brittany, did you have anything else that you wanted to add?
No, I think ending it on virtual is a really good place to leave it in light of all the crazy stuff we're dealing with the pandemic.
Great. Well, thank you, Chris Houston. Thank you so much for joining us this morning and giving us so much information and insight as your role as a mediator and from your long history of experience with mediations. And Brittany, thank you so much for taking your time out of your busy schedule to be with us this morning. Thank you all, everyone that joined in with us for sitting and listening to our discussion this morning. And as I mentioned, there's going to be a comment section and you can put your questions into that section. And if we can, we'll try to answer those questions. Ladies, did you have anything that you wanted to say as we end this discussion?
Just thank you for having me.
Yes, thank you for having me and for giving us the opportunity to talk about yet another form of dispute resolution.
Thank you.